Praise the Lord. I welcome you to a leadership training and development tonight in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Father, we do thank you for this hour. Thank you for this moment. Thank you because you've gathered us together so you can impart something into every life so that our ministry will make progress and we will accomplish our calling in Jesus' name. Open our eyes once again today so that your word will enrich our lives and your word will lift up, make our ministry to progress. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today we are coming to Psalm 32, very important psalm. And I'm reading verses 1 and 2. In Psalm 32, verse 1, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. And then in verse 2, it says, blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. As you look at those two verses of scripture, there's something very important that we learn. Number one, that justification by faith and receiving forgiveness and salvation from the Lord, and the Lord imparting his righteousness on us, is not peculiar to the New Testament. That the Old Testament believers also received the benefits of the reconciliation, the righteousness, the regeneration, and the spiritual resurrection coming from the Lord. As we look at those two verses, let's turn to Romans chapter 4, reading from verse 5. And you will see that the New Testament quotes from that, and it says in Romans chapter 4, verse 5, but to him that walketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. In verse 6, it then tells us that this faith that is counted for righteousness is referring back to David, what he said when he said in Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2, that God imputeth not the sin of the man unto him. Look at verse 6. It says, even as David also describeth the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works. And then in verse 7, it says in verse 7, saying, blessed are thee whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Now verse 8 is going to tell us, blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. What's the conclusion of that? As you come to that Romans chapter 4, in verse 22, it tells us in verse 22, and therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness. Verse 23 is asking now, it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him. All those Old Testament worthies, Abraham and David and many others, it wasn't just for them that it was imputed unto them for righteousness. Look at verse 24. It says in verse 24, but for us also, New Testament believers, for us also, those who are now partakers of the faithfulness of God, the goodness of God, the grace of God under the new covenant, but for us also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead. It says in verse 25, it says, who was delivered for offenses. Somebody bore the shame and bore the punishment on our behalf. He was delivered for offenses. He became our substitute. And because he was our substitute, that's why we cannot have justification by faith. He was raised again for our justification. As we compare Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2, with what we have in Romans chapter 4, we're looking at the New Testament gospel benefits for past and present believers. We're dividing the message to three parts. Number one is the blessing of forgiveness and salvation. for Old Testament people, for New Testament people, the blessing of forgiveness and salvation. Point number two, the benefits of faith in the sanctifier. Old Testament, New Testament, all who believe in the Lord and all who believe in the atoning work of the Lord Jesus Christ, for them in the Old Testament, it was still to come. For those in the New Testament, he came. And then for us who are there today now, he has come already. And he has made provision for the salvation, for the sanctification of everyone, the benefits of faith in the sanctifier. Point number three, the beneficiaries of the fullness of the Spirit. You will discover as you look at the Old Testament that there were people in the Old Testament that went into or that got into the provision of the Spirit of God for them. They had the forgiveness, they had the freedom, they had the fullness, according to their own time. And now we come to the New Testament and the New Covenant, and we can be beneficiaries of the fullness of the Spirit, the possibilities of the Spirit, the power of the Spirit, the promise of the Spirit, the beneficiaries of the fullness of the Spirit. Let's come to point number one. Point number one is talking about the blessing of forgiveness and salvation. Let's read Psalm 32 again, verses 1 and 2. And then as you read this, you're not just reading for other people, you read for yourself. And you say, this is mine. And the implication of what we are talking about, the forgiveness, the justification, the redemption, and the spiritual righteousness, the renewal, the refreshing, the revival, the implication of what we are talking about, you personalize and you appropriate, and you know that this is yours, not just for David. Look at Psalm 32 verse 1. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven. Happy is he whose transgression is forgiven. And it says, favored is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Whose sin is covered. That means the eyes of God will not look at those past sins anymore. The sin is covered. He puts the sinner in the sea of God's forgetfulness. As the east is far from the west, so has he removed our transgressions, our sins, our iniquities from us. And now he cannot say, because they are forgiven and they are forgotten, whose sin is covered. Look at verse 2. In verse 2 it says, blessed is the man. It's a personal salvation. It's a personal reconciliation with God. It's a personal experience with the Lord. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity. There is such a man. A man that believes, a man that takes the blessings of salvation, and now the Lord will not impute his sin, his past iniquity on him. And in whose spirit there is no guile. The Lord also looks at his spirit, and then he takes the depravity away, the sanctification, and there is no guile, and there is no root of sin again in the spirit, in whose spirit there is no guile. It tells us in Psalm 51, and we're reading from verse 12. Psalm 51, reading from verse 12. It says, restore unto me. Personal again, you see, there are people that think that salvation for the children of Israel was a national thing, was a corporate thing, was, God save the nation. It's talking about real salvation from sin. Restore unto me, personal, the joy of thy salvation. Do you remember what Jesus said? Rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Rejoice because you are born again. Rejoice because you are become a citizen of the kingdom of God. And in the Old Testament, they had that joy of salvation. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me with thy free spirit. As we look at this blessing of forgiveness and salvation, let's look at three things. Number one, the condition of forgiveness throughout the scriptures. It's not peculiar to the New Covenant, to the New Testament. The condition of forgiveness in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, the condition of forgiveness throughout the Scriptures. Psalm 32 again, and we're looking at verse 1. It says in Psalm 32 verse 1, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. How is this done? How is this provided? Look at Psalm 51. There is a condition. The condition of that forgiveness, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. In Psalm 51, reading from verse 1, it says, have mercy upon me. You see that? O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. He personalized it. He said, I'm the one that has sinned, and I want you to forgive all my sins. Look at verse 2. It says in verse 2, wash me thoroughly. Wash me thoroughly. That word thoroughly there is thoroughly. That's the old way of writing the word thoroughly. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. It says in verse 3, it says, for I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. It goes on in verse 4, and it says, against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. It's not going to tell us something that it wasn't just because of what he did. What he did was bad. What he did was defiling. What he did was sinful. But because of the nature in him, the depravity in him, it tells us in verse 5, it says, behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. It said, as a result of the fall of man, falling into sin, falling into degradation, and falling under the judgment of God, the nature of sin became implanted in the first parents, and then their descendants and their offspring and all the other people that followed. And as it came to him, and as it come to us, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Now, the condition of this forgiveness throughout the Scriptures. You see the confession there. You see there's repentance. It is as we turn away from the sin. That's what the Lord told Ezekiel. Tell the people, turn ye, O children of Israel, for why will ye die? I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. Look at this. But that the wicked should turn from his sin. There must be repentance. We're told in Acts chapter 5, verses 30 and 31. Acts chapter 5, verses 30 and 31, the God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. Can I remind you that if you're a preacher of the gospel, a preacher of the word of God, you have to be able to tell the sinner face to face, thou art the man. That's how they did it in the Old Testament, and this is how it happened in the New Testament. Peter preaching the word told the people, the God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. But look at this in verse 31. In verse 31, it says, him, that's Jesus, the one who was slain, the one who died on the cross, the one that they hanged on the tree, him as God exalted with his right hand. Look at this, to be a priest and to be a savior. To be a priest and to be a savior. For to give repentance to Israel, number one, for to give repentance to everyone in Israel, for to give repentance to everyone that will surrender, everyone that will yield, everyone that will submit to the call of God, to give, number one, repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Repentance, that's the condition, and then forgiveness. That's why we're told in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, 2 Peter chapter 3, reading from verse 9, it says that the Lord is not slack concerning his promise of sending Jesus back again to take us out of this world. The promise that he has given, that the Lord has gone to prepare a place for us. And when he goes to prepare a place for us, he will come again. Why has he not come? Look at this. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but his long suffering towards world, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Forgiveness is available for everyone. Salvation is available for everyone. And the substitutionary work of Christ on the cross of Calvary was done for everyone. But the Lord wants everyone all to come to repentance. That's the condition, repentance. That's the condition, Old Testament, New Testament. That's the condition, repentance, for the people in the first century of the church and for the people who are living today. If anyone is going to have forgiveness, it's not just repeating, forgive us, and we have done what we shouldn't have done. We have not done what we should have done. Repeating that like a parrot repeating something over and over. There must be the condition fulfilled, repentance before salvation, before forgiveness. Look at number two here. Number two is the confession and forsaking of all sin. We're coming to Isaiah chapter 55. We're reading from verse 6. It says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he's near. What do we do? And what should the sinner do when he comes to the Lord and he calls upon the Lord? The Lord is near. Everyone can come to the Lord because he's so near. He's near with salvation. He's near with forgiveness. He's near with cleansing of the heart. But what will the sinner do? Look at verse 7. It says in verse 7, let the wicked forsake his way. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him. Let him return unto the Lord. Here is the condition, and here is the confession. Here is the forsaking of sin. Let him return to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. I'm sure you have read Proverbs chapter 28 before. Let's look at that again. Proverbs chapter 28. We're reading from verse 9. He that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer shall be abomination. There are people that say, all I need is forgiveness. All I need is healing. All I need is deliverance. All I need is blessing. All I need is supernatural provision. All I need is a supply of my needs. I don't want to hear the word of God. I'm not for teaching. I'm not for preaching. I'm not for doctrine. Look at this. He that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, the word of God, even his prayer shall be abomination. Why? It says, Lord, I don't want to listen to you. I don't want to hear your will. I don't want to hear your word. And if he doesn't want to hear the word, but he says, but I'm going to pray. I want you to do this for me. God is saying, you count my word unacceptable, and you are not receiving my word. Because you count my word unacceptable and you reject my word, I speak to you, you will not hear. You speak to me, I will not hear as well. Even his prayer shall be abomination. And then he tells us in verse 13, he says, he that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them. The confession goes along with the forsaking. You confess, the sinner confesses, and the sinner forsakes a sin, and he does that with all his heart, with sincerity of heart. He does that with transparency of heart. Whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. That's Old Testament. Is that different in the New Testament? Come to Acts chapter 3, verse 19. Acts chapter 3, verse 19. Repent ye therefore. What's that? Turn away from sin. Therefore, what's that? Jettison, reject and throw away all sins thereof. What's that? Stop the sin and stop the things that bring the wrath of God, the indignation of God. Turn away from all that. You want his smile. You want his favor. You want his grace. You want his blessedness. Repent ye therefore and be converted. And be converted. What's that? And be changed. and be transformed. Let there be a new life. Let the new life replace the old life. Let there be a transformation. Let there be a renewal. Let there be a rejection of the past, and then the accommodation and the embracing of the new. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing, the times of renewal, and the times of revival, and the times of regeneration shall come from the presence of the Lord. Look at verse 26. In verse 26, it says, unto you first, God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you. Look at this. In turning away every one of you from his iniquities. That's what he does, and that's what he wants to do for every sinner. That's what he wants to do for every backslider, that you fulfill the condition of forgiveness, which is throughout the scriptures, and then you have the confession, the forsaking of all sin. We're told in Acts chapter 26, reading from verse 18, Acts chapter 26, verse 18, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive, look at this, forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Christ was talking to Paul. It's not faith in Paul. It's faith in the one talking to Paul, sanctified by faith that is in Christ. And we'll come to the third section here. There's conversion. There's conversion. And it says it is conversion through faith in the Savior. Already the psalmists have been praying to the Lord. The Lord is Savior. The Lord is Shepherd. The Lord is the substitute. The Lord is the sin bearer, and is praying to him. And conversion comes through faith in the Savior. Let's come back to the Psalms. Psalm 51, we're looking at verse 12. Psalm 51, verse 12, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Look at verse 13, conversion now. Then will I teach transgressors thy way? Then will I teach transgressors thy will? Then will I teach transgressors thy word, and I will show them, I will tell them the same way I was saved. I will reveal to them, and I will reveal to them that you are a pardoning God, that you are a forgiving God, that you are a faithful God. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. And sinners shall be converted unto thee. They don't just come for empty worship and worshiping the Lord. They don't just come for superficial prayer and praying to the Lord. Their hearts are actually converted, and their lives are converted, and their practices converted. And sinners shall be converted unto thee. There is conversion. Look at Psalm 19. I'm reading from verse 7. In Psalm 19, verse 7, it says, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. It converts the soul, the mind, the spirit, the character, the behavior. When we hear the word of God, this Old Testament, and the Old Testament says there's something called conversion, and the law of the Lord is so perfect, and it converts the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. And then it comes to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 15, verse 3. The same conversion we see in the old, we see that same conversion in the new. And it says in Acts chapter 15, verse 3, and being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring, look at what they were declaring, the conversion of the Gentiles, and they caused great joy unto all the brethren. The Gentiles and the people that were sinners, when they heard the gospel, they heard the word of God. What happened to them? They repented. What happened to them? They fulfilled the condition of forgiveness and salvation. What happened to them? They believed on the Lord, the Savior, who died for them on the cross of Calvary. And then a transformation took place. It's the work of God. It's the work of grace. It's the work of his goodness that they were now converted, and there was great joy among the brethren that those Gentiles received the same salvation, the same conversion, and the same forgiveness, and the same freedom, and the same hope of heaven as they had. They declared the conversion of the Gentiles, and they caused great joy unto all the brethren. How does that happen today? Romans chapter 10, reading from verse 9. In Romans chapter 10, reading from verse 9, it says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lordship of Jesus, the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Thou shalt be converted. Thou shalt be forgiven. The joy of salvation will come. The assurance of salvation will come. You confess with your mouth that Jesus is now your Lord. Jesus is now your director. Jesus is now your controller. And you have invited him in, and he takes over your life. Jesus is my Lord. And then you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead for your justification. Thou shalt be saved, thou shalt be forgiven, thou shalt be converted, thou shalt be transformed, and thou shalt have the joy of salvation. It says in verse 10, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. If you truly believe, and the righteous one comes into your heart and he takes absolute control, you'll be righteous. He gives you his righteousness. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Look at verse 13. In verse 13, it says, this is for everyone, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How do you have the faith to call upon the name of the Lord? Believe what you are hearing. Look at verse 17. In verse 17, so then faith cometh, the faith to be saved, faith cometh, the faith to have assurance of salvation, faith cometh, the faith to know for sure that all your sins are forgiven, all your sins are covered, and he does not impute that sin unto you anymore. How do you have that faith? That you know and you are very sure and definite that now all your sins are taken away. The faith for total salvation, conversion, transformation. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Hearing by the word of God. Other people receive this too. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. We're reading from verse 5. This same conversion and this same transformation happened unto them. It says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 verse 5. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, shallow, empty, ineffective. A word did not come to you like that. The gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance. When the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, when he takes that word and he pinpoints you and applies it into your heart, it will come with conviction. It will come with confidence in the Lord. It will come with consecration and confession. And then you go to the Lord and he does a work of grace in your heart. And there is much assurance as you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. Look at verse 6. In verse 6 it says, and ye became followers of us. Ye became, that's conversion. You became what you were not before. There's transformation. There is a new life. And there's regeneration. And you became followers of us, living like we are living, and of the Lord. Everything the Lord has said, you are following that now, because there is regeneration. There is conversion. There is a new life. Having received the word in much affliction and with joy of the Holy Ghost. In verse 7, it says in verse 7, so that ye were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. And then in verse 8, it says, so from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place, your faith for forgiveness, your faith for renewal, your faith for salvation, but your faith for new life, your faith to God's word is spread abroad so that we need not speak anything. And then in verse 9, it says in verse 9, for they themselves show of us what manner of entering in we urge unto you. Look at this, and how ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. You see conversion there. Forgiveness comes with conversion. Somebody cannot just say, I'm forgiven, but my life is still the same. I'm forgiven, but I'm still chewing what I was chewing. I'm still drinking what I was drinking. I'm still going the bad way, the defiling way, even though I'm forgiven. No, there is a turning to God from idols. There's a turning to God from iniquity. There's a turning to God from transgression to now serve the living and true God. And then in verse 10, it says, and to wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. We come to point number two now. As we come to point number two, we're looking at the benefits of faith in the sanctifier. We're coming to Psalm 32, and we're reading from verse 2. Psalm 32, looking at verse 2, blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity. All the past is forgiven and forgotten, and in whose spirit there is no guile. In whose spirit there is no guile. This is the work of God, is the work of grace, and is the work that brings godliness into the life of this person that comes for the full salvation of the Lord. Look at the way the psalmist prayed in Psalm 51, reading from verse 6. Psalm 51, reading from verse 6. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts. It's not just a superficial cleansing or the cutting off of the branches on the tree of sin, but God desires truth in the inward parts. And in the hidden part, in the depth of the heart, thou shalt make me to know wisdom. And then in verse 7, it says, purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. That's one stage. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, look at this, and I shall be white. I shall be whiter than snow. If there is salvation, and you are white as snow when he cleanses you, when he forgives you, and then you come back to the Lord and he says, cleanse me again, wash me again, purge me again, and I shall be whiter than snow. Look at verse 10. In verse 10, it tells us, create in me a clean heart, O God. You understand? It's saying, this old heart, give me a replacement and give me a change. Create in me. There's going to be a new creation. He has a faith that the Lord who did the original creation is able to create again. So he says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Was praying with assurance, with faith, that God is able to do that. We're coming back to Psalm 32, and we're reading from verse 2. There are three things here we're looking at. Number one, the imputation of righteousness to the penitent. We're looking at Psalm 32, and we're reading from verse 2. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity. Just overlooks the iniquity and goes over the iniquity and forgets the iniquity. It takes the iniquity away from the book of records. They're not written there anymore. He blots away the iniquity, and he imputes not again, and will not bring it to remembrance again, and then in whose spirit there is no guile. Let me give you an illustration of that imputation of righteousness to the penitent. In 2 Samuel chapter 19, verse 19. Second Samuel chapter 19, we're reading from verse 19. Here is when Shimei came to David and said to the king, "Let not my Lord impute iniquity unto me. Yes, I said what I said, and it was bad, it was sin, it was transgression, it was iniquity. I come for pardon. I come that you look at me as if I didn't say that foolish thing. I didn't do that foolish thing, casting stones at you and throwing aspersions at you. Let not my Lord impute iniquity unto me. Neither do thou remember that which thy servant did perversely." You see that when it says it does not impute iniquity unto the penitent, it means don't remember all those things I did perversely the day that my Lord the king went out of Jerusalem, that the king should take it to his heart. Look at verse 20. In verse 20 it says, "For thy servant doth know that I have sinned with that confession and with that acceptance and asking for mercy, not to impute his iniquity unto him," not to remember the iniquity. It says, "For thy servant doth know that I have sinned. Therefore, behold, I am come the first this day." I come. If the sinner is going to be forgiven, if the sinner is going to have all the sins forgotten, all the sins not imputed unto him, he must come to the Lord he has offended. "I am come the first this day, that of all the house of Joseph, to go down to meet my Lord the king. I accept you as king. I believe you are the king, and accept you as the Lord in the nation, and mind my Lord the king in particular." That's how the imputation now comes. We're coming to the New Testament in Romans chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 5. Romans chapter 4, reading from verse 5. "But to him that walketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness." His faith in the goodness of God, his faith in the grace of God, his faith in the promises of God. The promise that says, "Whosoever comes to me, I will in no wise cast out, I will not cast off." His faith is counted for righteousness. And then in verse 6, it tells us in verse 6, it says, "Even as David also describeth the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works." In verse 7, it says in verse 7, saying, "Blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered." Verse 8 says, in verse 8, "Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin." When we're born again, we don't keep on remembering what God has forgotten, what he has put in the sea of his own forgetfulness. And he says, "I don't remember that against you anymore. Blessed is that man. Favored is that man. Happy is that man. Happy is that convert to whom the Lord will not impute sin." And you know, sometimes maybe you are trying to do something, get over a hurdle, and then you are not able to get over. And your mind, the devil might bring it into your mind. You are suffering for the sins of the past. You see now, that's what you did. Whatever a man sows, that's what he's going to reap. What you sowed, the Lord has uprooted, and the Lord has thrown away, and the Lord imputes righteousness unto you as if you never sinned at all. He cannot remember. That's why it says you are happy and you are blessed. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. It tells us in verse 22 of that Romans chapter 4, it says, "And therefore it was imputed to him for righteousness." Verse 23 tells us, "Now it was not written for his sake alone that it was imputed to him." And in verse 24 it says, "But for us also." But for me also. The Lord does not remember the past, and I don't remember. But for me also, The Lord justifies the one that comes to the Lord, and the Lord has justified me, but for me also. And the Lord looks at me, justified as if I never sinned, and he cannot remember all those foolish things, all those filthy things that I did before I came to him. And if he does not remember, I don't remember too, and I don't recall it and bring it to mind anymore, but for me also, but for us also, but for you also, to whom it shall be imputed, if we believe on him that raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead. Actually, we're told in verse 25, it says in verse 25, he was delivered for offenses, and he was raised again for justification. That's why reconciliation comes. That's why we now rejoice in the reconciliation, righteousness, regeneration, renewal, transformation of the Lord. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, reading from verse 19. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we're reading from verse 19, to which that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. He wants to do it for the whole world, to forgive their sins and to forget all about their sins, and not to impute any transgressions to them. It says, to wit, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. Look at this. Not imputing their trespasses unto them. Available for everyone. Available for those who have not got it yet. Not imputing their trespasses unto them. And he has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. In verse 20, that's why he now says, now, then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead. We pray you standing as representatives of Christ. Be ye reconciled unto God. There is imputation of righteousness to the penitent. But the Lord goes even beyond that. There is impartation. Impartation of righteousness to the purified. Look at Romans chapter 5, verse 19. Romans chapter 5, verse 19. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Made righteous. It's not just that, well, continue whatever you're doing, but I count you righteous. It goes beyond that. He has imputed the righteousness of Christ unto us at salvation. But now, our nature that had been depraved, our nature that was falling, our nature that was sinful, he now imparts the righteousness unto us, that by the obedience of one, the obedience of Christ, it shall now, many shall now be made righteous. Look at Romans chapter 6, we're reading from verse 18. Romans chapter 6, reading from verse 18. Being then made, look at that word made. I want you to underline that in your Bible, that then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. Being made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. Look at verse 22. In verse 22, it says, but now, the past is gone, but now, a new day has begun, but now redemption has come, but now you have believed on the sacrifice of Jesus your Savior, Jesus your sin bearer, and Jesus your sanctifier. But now, being made free from sin and become servants to God, you become. You're no more what you used to be because of the change that has taken place in the heart. It says, and become servants to God, ye have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. Now, he is even made to us everything from salvation, justification, redemption, sanctification. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, reading from verse 30. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, reading from verse 30, it says, but of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom. Not the natural wisdom. Now we can have spiritual, supernatural wisdom. and righteousness, not self-righteousness, we can have his own righteousness and sanctification. And sanctification is made unto us, sanctification and redemption, full redemption. Actually, he tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, reading from verse 21, it says, for he has made him to be sin for us. He has made him to be the representative of sinful humanity. And then he has taken our sin upon himself, and he became the sin offering for us. He has made him. The Heavenly Father, our God, our Creator, has made him, the only begotten Son, to be sin for us. He replaced us. He took our place completely. Who knew no sin? He was holy. He was spotless. He was blameless. He was perfect. He knew no sin, no sin in his nature, no sin in his character, no sin in his utterance, no sin private, no sin secret. He knew no sin, but that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. We come into Christ, and as we come into Christ, we are now made the righteousness of God in Christ. What a privilege we have. What a cleansing we have. What a purging we have. What a purifying we have. What sanctification we have. In Titus chapter 2 verse 14, Titus chapter 2 verse 14, who gave himself for us a substitute, who gave himself for us our Savior, who gave himself for us our Redeemer, who gave himself for us, our sanctifier, that he might redeem us from all iniquity. Look at this. And purify unto himself a peculiar people, a purified people, a special people, a holy people, a person, a group of people that have no blemish, all that has been taken away, because he purifies unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. You see, did he do that only for a few people? And not everybody can take part in that. Not everybody can receive that. It's for all. The goodness of the Lord is for all. And the grace of the Lord is for all. He is impartial. Let's come to the Old Testament. We're looking at Psalm 145, Psalm 145. I'm reading from verse 9. I'm reading from verse 19. In Psalm 145, look at verse 9. The Lord is good to all. No partiality. The Lord is good to all. Anyone who comes, mercy is available. Anyone who comes, forgiveness available. Anyone who comes, freedom from sin available. Anyone who comes, all the benefits of faith are available. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works, over all his creation. Look at verse 19. It says in verse 19, he will fulfill the desire of them that fear him. You honor the Lord, you come to the Lord, you fear the judgment that might come, and you don't want that judgment, and you desire to be saved. The Lord cannot push you away, and it's not partial. The impartiality of the righteous, our propitiation, he will fulfill the desire of them that fear him. He also will hear their cry and will save them. Salvation available for everyone. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. 1 John chapter 2. We're reading from verse 1, my little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. You have the grace, that ye sin not. You have the impartation of the righteousness of God, that ye sin not. You have the power to hold your ground, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, and if accidentally any man sin, and if by carelessness any man sin, And if by being tricked and tempted and tried, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Jesus Christ the righteous is pleading for us and is the advocate with the Father. And then in verse 2, look at his impartiality, and he is the propitiation. He, Christ, is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The impartiality of the righteous, a propitiation. Look at chapter 3 of Romans. Romans chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 24. In Romans chapter 3, verse 24, it tells us, being justified freely, available free of charge, available because Christ paid it all. He has paid the price for your redemption. He has paid the price for the imputation. He has paid the price for the impartation. Being justified freely by his grace, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Verse 25, it says in verse 25, on whom God has set forth to be a propitiation, him has God set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission, the forgiveness, the removal, the forgetting of the sins that are past, through the forbearance of God. It's available. Look at Romans now, chapter 10, and we're reading from verse 12. Romans chapter 10, verse 12, God is no respecter of persons, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Gentile. There is no difference between the white and the black. There's no difference between the old and the young. There's no difference between the religious and the irreligious, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. The Lord is rich unto all with salvation, with forgiveness, with redemption. The Lord is rich unto all that call upon him. That's why it says in verse 13, it says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's now available, the salvation of the Lord, for whosoever and for everyone. That's why it says in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Romans chapter 1, verse 16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone. Everyone, no partiality. Everyone, no one will be rejected. To everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. In verse 17, it says, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed, the righteousness of God imputed, the righteousness of God imparted, the righteousness of God is given. Herein, therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. As you come to the Lord, he justifies and he makes you righteous, and the just shall live by faith. We're told in Galatians chapter 3, reading from verse 11. Galatians chapter 3, we're reading from verse 11. In verse 11 it says, but that no man is justified by the law is in the sight of God is evident. Look at this. For the just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. And then in verse 14, it says that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles, no exception, no partiality, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. In verse 28, it says, there is neither Jew nor Greek, There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. No partiality come, and he will impute his righteousness unto you. He will impart his righteousness unto you. He will even impart his spirit unto you. Point number three now. In point number three, we're looking at the beneficiaries of the fullness of the Spirit. We'll come back to Psalm 51, reading from verse 10. Psalm 51, verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. A right spirit within me. Take the spirit that always wants to go astray and take a wrong step, wants to look in the wrong direction, wants to lean in the wrong direction, wants to lean on something false, and put your spirit, the right spirit within me. And then let's look there at verse 11. In verse 11, cast me not away from thy presence. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Holy Spirit, and let that remain in me. It's asked for forgiveness. It's asked for impartation of righteousness. It's asked for the creation of a new heart and a new spirit. It's asked to be made whiter than snow. It now wants the Holy Spirit to abide and to remain in him. And then it says in verse 13, when I have that spirit and when I have the joy of the fullness coming back, then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. Look at Psalm 143, verse 10. Psalm 143, we're looking at verse 10. The Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Spirit, the free spirit, and the fullness of the Spirit, he knew that he couldn't do and he couldn't be everything he ought to do, everything he ought to be without the Spirit of God. That's why he prayed, teach me to do thy will. For thou art my God, thy spirit is good. Thy spirit is good, controlling me, guiding me, directing me, and leading me. Thy spirit is good. I do not want to miss the presence of your spirit. Lead me into the land of uprightness. You understand David praying and saying in Psalm 51, saying, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Number one, he was a partaker of the spirit in a prophet. The spirit in a prophet. David was a partaker. We're looking at 1 Samuel chapter 16, reading from verse 13. 1 Samuel chapter 16, reading from verse 13. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him, that's David, in the midst of his brethren, and the Spirit of the Lord, and the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of God came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel rose up and went to Ramah, and that spirit began to work immediately. In verse 23, we're told, and it says, it came to pass when the spirit, when the evil spirit from God was upon Saul, that Saul, the first king of Israel, that David took an harp and played with his hand, so that so Saul was refreshed and was well, and the evil spirit departed from him. The Spirit of God was on David. He was saved. He was made whiter than snow. A new heart was created. He was sanctified. He had the Spirit of God. Let's look at 2 Samuel and see the manifestation of that Spirit. 2 Samuel chapter 23, verses 1 and 2. The manifestation of that Spirit upon David. It says, now these be the last words of David. David, the son of Jesse, the man who was raised up on high, the anointed of God, of the God of Jacob, the sweet psalmist of Israel, said, look at verse 2. It says in verse 2, the Spirit of the Lord spake by me. The Spirit of the Lord indwelt him, controlled him, led him, gave him utterance. The Spirit of the Lord spake by me. His word was in my tongue. His word was in my tongue. And let's look at Mark chapter 12. We're looking at verse 36, talking about David and the Spirit of God. The Spirit in the prophet came unto him, for David himself said, by the Holy Ghost, look at that. David himself said, by the Holy Ghost, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou on my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool. He had the Spirit of prophecy. We're looking at Acts chapter 2, reading from verse 29. Acts chapter 2, reading from verse 29. Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David. Let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David. And then he says in verse 30 that he, in verse 30, this David, who was of the Lord, and he had the Spirit of God on him, and the Spirit in a prophet. And then the apostle said, let me talk to you about David the patriarch. Therefore, being a prophet, look at that. Therefore, he was a king, he was also a prophet, being a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne. And then he goes on with the prophecy he gave. You look at 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 21. All the prophets of the Old Covenant, all the prophets of the Old Testament, and now David identified as a prophet. It says, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men, forgiving men, sanctified men, men that were made whiter than snow, holy men of God spake, past tense, old covenant, they spake as they were moved, as they were carried along, as they were driven, as they were given utterance by the Holy Ghost. So, in the Old Testament, David had the Holy Spirit, and those prophets had the Holy Spirit, and many others had the Holy Spirit, the partaker of the Spirit in a prophet. Number two, the promise is now given. The promise has actually been given from the Old Testament. In Isaiah chapter 59, reading from verse 19. Isaiah chapter 59, verse 19. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun. Look at this. When the enemy shall come like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up his standard against him. That's the promise the Lord gave to those worthies of old. And then in verse 21, it says in verse 21, as for me, here is the Lord talking. He says, as for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord, my spirit that is upon thee, and my words which I have put in thy mouth, the spirit and the word and the spirit in the heart, the word in the mouth, and my words which I have put in thy mouth shall not depart out of thy mouth, nor out of the mouth of thy seed, nor out of the mouth of thy seed, says the Lord, from henceforth forever. It tells us in Joel chapter 2, the promise of the Spirit of power. In Joel chapter 2, reading from verse 28, Joel chapter 2, verse 28, and it shall come to pass, here is the promise of the Spirit of power, it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, Jews and Gentiles, upon all flesh, men and women, upon all flesh, all who are saved, all who are sanctified, all who desire, all who pray, all who believe, all who have the imputation of righteousness and the impartation of righteousness, all those who are washed and as white as snow, all those who are cleansed and they are purged and they are whiter than snow, I will bring and pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. And then we're told in verse 29, it says, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit. That is the promise of the Lord. And when the Holy Ghost came upon the disciples, all who were waiting on the day of Pentecost, Peter recollected, and Peter remembered, and Peter reminded the people. It says in Acts chapter 2, reading from verse 16, but this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. What did Joel say in verse 17? Verse 17 says, and it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. That's the promise for you and for me. That's the promise for both the men and the women, both the brothers and the sisters. And I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. It tells us in verse 18, and on my servants and on my handmaidens, I will pour out, in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. Look at verse 39. In verse 39, it says, for the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. You can have that spirit of power, that spirit of prophecy, and that spirit of all possibilities. Even now, you're saved, you're sanctified, you come with faith, and you come, nothing in your hand you are bringing, and it's not by crying, it's not by beating on the chair, it's not by rolling on the ground, it's not even by fasting. It is the free gift of God that he now makes available. He gives us to become possessors of the spirit of all possibilities. Look at the promise of the Lord. He gives us the promise, and that promise is yours, and that promise can be ours even today. We're coming to Acts chapter 1. We're looking at verse 4. In Acts chapter 1, reading from verse 4, it says, and being assembled together with them, he commanded that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait. We must pray. In our church, it looks like we give much attention to the preaching of the word and teaching of the word, and we do not give enough time to personal prayer. We do not have enough time for congregational prayer. We do not have enough time waiting upon the Lord. It says, but wait. That's the commandment of the Lord. If we are going to have the fulfillment of the promise of power, it says, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith, ye have heard of me. And then in verse 5, it says, for John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized and immersed and dipped and overwhelmed and enveloped. Ye shall be endued with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. And then in verse 8, it says, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. That Holy Ghost in his power, that Holy Ghost in all his possibilities can come upon you and upon us afresh, because it's the promise of the Father, but he shall receive power. the Spirit of power. He shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Luke chapter 24, reading from verse 49. In Luke chapter 24, verse 49, here is what Jesus said as he gave the promise, and behold, I sent. And behold, I sent. He was going to heaven, and when he arrives there, he was going to send the promise of the Father. And behold, I sent the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry. Let's wait, but tarry. He's telling us to tarry and to wait, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until how long are we going to wait? How long are we going to tarry? Until the Spirit comes, until the power comes, until we're filled, until we're saturated, until we have that Spirit in our soul, in our mind, in our spirit, within us and upon us. It says, until ye be endued with power from on high. That power will come. I said that power will come, but you'll tarry and you'll wait in the presence of the Lord with prayer, with desire, with passion, and you're telling the Lord, oh Lord, you've imputed your righteousness, I thank you. You've imparted your righteousness, I thank you. Now I need the impartation of the anointing and the power and the Spirit of God. And as you wait on the Lord, he will do it. You'll become a possessor. Number three now, possessors of the Spirit of all possibilities. Possessors of the Spirit of all possibilities. When the Spirit comes upon the sanctified believer, there are many possibilities in the life of that believer. As he's moved, as he's guided, as he's directed, as he's enveloped, as he's endowed, and as he's infilled, as he's saturated with the Spirit of power, possibilities in our lives. Look at Matthew chapter 3, verse 11. Matthew chapter 3, and we're looking at verse 11. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. I dip you, I immerse you inside the river, inside the water, because you have repented. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you, he shall immerse you, he shall totally subdue you, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with power and with fire. The fire of the Holy Ghost comes, and all the lethargy, all the lukewarmness is burnt away, all the coldness is burnt away, all the lukewarmness and all the, you know, all the sitting back, all that is burnt away. He brings fire and he brings fervency, and he burns everything that is chaff, everything that ought not to be in our lives. He burns everything away. And then in verse 12, he says, in verse 12, whose fan in his hand is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather the wheat into the garner. But it will burn the chaff, everything useless, everything unprofitable. It will burn the chaff. It'll burn everything that is occupying space in your life, occupying space in your ministry, but it's not making you progressive. It'll burn the chaff with unquenchable fire. That's a possibility of the Holy Ghost as he gives us the power and the infilling and the baptism in the Holy Ghost. It tells us in Luke chapter 12, reading from verse 12. Luke chapter 12, we're looking at it from verse 12. It's saying, for the Holy Ghost shall teach you in that same hour what ye ought to say. Well, you don't know what to say. Here is another possibility. We have the power, the power to work miracles, the anointing to break every yoke, and the fire and the fervency. We have that because of the Holy Ghost. Not only that, the power, the Spirit of utterance, the Holy Ghost comes upon us and he pulls in our heart and he gives us the message and he gives us the word. For the Holy Ghost shall teach you in that same hour what ye ought to say. In John chapter 14, reading from verse 26. John chapter 14, and we're looking at verse 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, will not be ignorant. I don't know that revelation. I don't have that revelation. I can't interpret that in the Bible. I don't know how, what to make of this in the Bible. This Holy Ghost, when it comes in us, it says it will teach us all things, teach us all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. It brings into our remembrance, even as we are getting old and older, and they say, well, they'll forget, they'll not know this again, they'll not know their left from right. It will quicken us. And then it says, the Spirit will bring to remembrance anything, everything whatsoever he has said unto us. These are the possibilities we have as we are baptized, as we are immersed, as we are filled, as we are enveloped, as we are saturated with the Holy Ghost. In Acts chapter 4, reading from verse 31, Acts chapter 4, reading from verse 31, it says, and they, when they had prayed, the place was shaking, you know, when they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost. They were all, they had been saved, they had been sanctified, they had been baptized in the Holy Ghost before this time. They prayed again, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. It gives us fearlessness. It gives us courage. It gives us boldness to declare the word of God anywhere, everywhere, whatever the challenge, whatever the circumstance, in that place you are ministering, here is the possibility of the Holy Ghost, that they speak the word of God with boldness. Acts chapter 15, we're reading from verse 8. Acts chapter 15, reading from verse 8, it says, and God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, as even as he did unto us. Many years after the day of Pentecost, after the disciples, the apostles had received the Holy Ghost, Peter came to the house of Cornelius, and this is the promise, and this is the testimony, that the power of the Holy Ghost has not changed, and that the possibilities in the Holy Ghost, they have not changed. And the same thing today we need to understand. He knows the hearts of all people. He knows our desire. He knows our passion. He knows our pursuit. He knows how we want the power and the possibilities of the Holy Ghost. And he makes no difference. He gives us the same Holy Ghost, even as he did unto them. In verse 9, it says in verse 9, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Romans chapter 5, looking at verse 5, what the Holy Ghost does and what he spreads from our heart unto the hearts of other people, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. The love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Our heart will not just be neutral to everyone. I'm neutral. I don't feel anything. I don't think anything. I'm neutral to them. If they go up, all right. If they go down, all right. You'll not be neutral. The Spirit of God filling your heart will fill you with love, and then that love will be shed abroad in your heart by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. It tells us in Romans chapter 8, verse 2. In Romans chapter 8, verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life, is the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, has made me free from the law of sin and death. And then in verse 11, it tells us in verse 11, but the Spirit of him, if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies. He make your body come alive. He'll drive sickness away from there. He makes your body his temple. He makes your body his sanctuary. He makes your body his house. And if he finds any kind of spiritual thing that not ought to be there, he drives them away. We are also quickened in our mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in us. Romans chapter 15, we're looking at verse 19, through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God. When the Spirit of God abides in us, there'll be mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. That Spirit can come upon you and upon me and upon us afresh today. And there will be signs and wonders. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 2 and reading from verse 4. Hebrews chapter 2, we're looking at verse 4. It tells us that this is what the Lord does. Is giving, is bearing them witness and is bringing testimony. God also bearing them witness with signs and wonders. God also bearing us witness with signs and wonders. Anywhere you go, anywhere we go, God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders and with diverse miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his will. According to his will. We've learned today that what's available for us now without measure was available for the Old Testament people with a measure. Forgiveness available from that time till this time. Repentance is honored by the Lord from that time unto this time. Imputation of righteousness from that time until this time. Impartation of righteousness from that time until this time. And the power, the infilling, and the outpouring of the Holy Ghost available more than that time is available today. And the Lord is saying, it's an impartial God. Whosoever cometh to the Lord, he will not push away, he will not drive away, he'll fulfill the good desires of his people. The Lord is good to all. It's good to all that come to him. You can come now. The Lord is good unto all. Let's rise up and take whatever we have learned to the Lord in prayer. Rise up now and tell the Lord, we know that these New Testament gospel benefits in the past was available, in the present is also available. Talk to the Lord, talk to the Lord. We don't have enough time to take everything to the Lord, and we ought to wait on the Lord after this time, and we ought to seek the face of the Lord after this time, so that we will be able to get everything, the assurance and the confidence. Number one, you know that God, when he forgives, he forgets all sins. He does not impute our transgressions unto us anytime, anymore. And whatever is happening, he looks at you as if you had never committed any sin at all. When you are justified, when you are forgiven, he sets you free. And then he gives you the grace for godliness, the grace to move on in the assurance. You are forgiven, you are set free, and you are made righteous in the Lord. And Christ becomes our righteousness, imputed, imparted unto us. And then we have the Spirit in the prophets of the old covenant, and the Spirit in the disciples, apostles of the new covenant, the Spirit of power, and the Spirit of all possibilities. All that is yours. All that is mine. All that is ours. He answers prayer. Believe him, he'll move you forward. You'll make progress in the things of the Lord. Father, we thank you today. We bless your name for what you have done. We thank you for the imputation of righteousness. We thank you for your love, that everyone who has repented, everyone who has come before you, you forgive, and you'll not remember their sins anymore. We pray, as you don't remember, give us the faith. We don't remember as well anymore. In Jesus' name, the new life of being as white as snow, and the new life of being whiter than snow, impart and grant to everybody, and let it be a real definite experience, and the work of grace, the work of God, and the work of your goodness in every life, in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray in practical ways at home, in practical ways in the church, in practical ways in the office, in practical ways anywhere we are. We will live the life of righteousness, spotless, holy, blameless, sanctified, perfect in Christ, in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, the outpouring of your Spirit. We pray the immersion in your Spirit and the infilling of your Spirit, the saturation in your Spirit and the empowerment in your Spirit. You grant unto every one of us that will have power. You grant to every one of us who have the possibilities of the Holy Ghost in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. Fulfill your word. And Lord, help us that every kind of lukewarmness, lethargy, everything is burnt off by the fire of the Holy Ghost. And we'll keep on moving, never getting tired in the work of the Lord in Jesus' name. Lord, we know you are faithful. Let your people understand. Let your people believe. Let your people receive of your goodness and your faithfulness in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. Thank you, and God bless you.